Okay, welcome back, everybody. Today, we're going to talk about tasting, the science behind tasting, why it's so important, all of the five tasting senses, and how to enhance your ability to understand those different senses. So anyways, I'd say let's get started. So today, we're going to talk about the five basic tastes, the anatomy of tasting, the hard and soft palate that we have in our mouths, the role of saliva, and the five different tastes and trials that you can do to develop your understanding of those tastes. So, taste. It's also known as gustation. Taste is a really common slang. It's as a combination of odor, taste, texture, and temperature. They all play a very... all play different roles in what our first impression of taste is when we taste something. But for our definition, taste is just the five senses. There's only five basic tastes. So salty, oh, you can see it right next to my head here. Oh, other way. Salty, sweet, bitter, sour, and umami. Those are the five basic tastes. So, for example, if you were to take an apple, an onion, and a potato, you were to blend them each up into, like, a sauce. Blindfold yourself and then, like, clip your nose or pinch your nose so you can't see it, you can't smell it. You're relying completely just on taste. It would actually be nearly impossible to determine which one was which because the texture is now very similar. You can't smell it and you can't see it. So that's kind of an odd thing about tasting. And the way that I remember it is, like, when I was really little, I would get sick a lot and I'd have to... down a lot of cough syrup. I just thought cough syrup was just like the most disgusting thing ever. Like anything liquid medicine, I hate it so much. Give me a pill any day or like shoot it in my arm. I don't care. But for whatever reason, liquid medicine is like my worst nightmare. But my mom always told me to plug my nose and then drink it so that way I wouldn't have to smell it going down. And once you unplug your nose, you get that retronasal grossness, but you could drink something like water or, you know, milk to flush it down. Hopefully you didn't have to suffer more than you needed to. So that's kind of like a really good example of how limited our tastes are. We only have five tastes. What we smell and the texture and the temperature, all the combination together is how we perceive things. So let's get a little more into this. So yes, taste and smell interact very closely in how we perceive food and beverages. This slide should be very familiar to you from our wine quality section. This is just a little bit of a review. Early man relied on taste to determine if food was safe. So things that were bitter were most often poisonous or spoiled. So that's why we've kind of developed an unlikeness to bitter things, except for all the people who love IPAs, of course, for whatever reason. Foods that are higher in calorie are often sweet. So they contain a lot of sugar, contain a lot of glucose, a lot of energy compounds. So that's something that we have evolved to be attracted to. Taste is perceived in our taste buds, primarily on the tongue, but also all around the oral cavity as well. Sorry, I'm going to try and move my head so I'm not in the way. Okay, so there are nerves in our taste buds. So the act of tasting starts with receptor cells in the taste buds that are located mostly on the tongue, but also in other parts of the oral cavity. So there are some in other places. Taste cells communicate with neural taste fibers that communicate with the brain. So you can see the little fibers coming through here, the nerve fibers connecting to the taste buds and the connecting tissue in between them as well. So the number of taste cells communicate with neural tissue fibers that communicate with the brain. So this is just kind of a very straightforward, like, yeah, the buds were activated. You know, they send a signal down the nerve fibers, and nerve fibers communicate with the brain, kind of a deal. I know that's a very dumbed-down version, but we don't need to know the neuroscience or anything super complex for the purpose of this class. However, there are a lot less taste receptors in our mouth than there are olfactory receptors involved in smelling. So just how we only can taste like five different sensations or tastes, basically, we can, you know, smell millions and millions of different scents. So it makes a big difference on what we can do. Super tasters. We've already talked about this. I just put it in the slide just as a reminder. You can look at that if you'd like. The palate. Yes. So the palate. What is the palate? We're not talking about a palate, Jack. We're not talking about a palate of wine. We're talking about the palate in our mouths. So it's a noun. So it's the roof. First definition, it's the roof of the mouth separating the cavities of the nose and the mouth. So, yes. So we have our palate here. Literal palate. The slang that we know, mostly people use it in, like, casually in evaluations of wine or, like, food critics, wine critics will refer to palate as a person's appreciation of taste and flavor, especially when sophisticated and discriminating. So if someone has a developed palate, I have a palate for fermented garlic. This person does not have a palate for whatever. That's kind of the sense that we use a lot of it for. There is a soft palate and a hard palate. The soft palate is mostly what perceives taste in our mouths, and that is the softer section in the back of our mouths. There's also a hard palate, which is located on the roof of your mouth. This does not perceive taste, but it is more involved in touch, which is our next lecture, so we'll get more into that in the next lecture, along with tannins. Tannins are involved with tactile touch because it receives your mouth a sensation. So that's going to be in our next lecture as well. So hard palate, as you can kind of see in this picture here, hard palate is also related to like retronasal. We're talking about the airflow here, how the air is coming out of the nose. So it enters in through the mouth, it goes over the tongue and into your throat. So that's kind of the soft palate. And then as you exhale, that is more of the hard palate up top. So just kind of interesting. Here is another picture of the hard palate. So there are some taste buds involved, like we just discussed a couple slides back, in other places of your mouth besides your tongue, supposedly. But mostly not. Okay, mostly our tongue is what perceives these things. Well, the reason why we involve the oral cavity in this definition is because it's involved in touch or texture sensations. So like your lips and your gums are involved with touch. You know, you think of, if you ever fed a horse before, how you see their lip move, their lips are moving like towards the hay or something to feel, they're feeling with their massive lips. That's involved in touch. It's a sensation that's helping them understand, am I eating some nice lovely grass or hay, or is this a rock I'm about to hurt my tooth on? You know, that's part of how that works. The hard palate is involved with touch. Again, the soft palate is involved with taste. The tongue, touch and taste. We do touch with our tongue and understand, you know, what we have in our mouth. The lower lips and gums, touch, and your cheeks are also touch sensations. So that's how those are all involved together. So there's been some new research on taste. I personally need to look more into this. You're welcome to look into it if you'd like. But according to our textbook, even though they told us just a couple of chapters back that the different sections of the tongue and sour, sweet, salty, and umami, apparently this is not completely true to how our tongue works. It's not necessarily, this is what the research has been thought to be for a very long time until recently. These convenient groupings are not really the way this works necessarily anymore. New research kind of shows that we have these tasting sensations widespread over the tongue and other parts of the oral cavity as well. So, and everyone's genetics are a little bit differently, and some people are more sensitive to some things than others. Some people are more sensitive to sour. Some people are very sensitive to sweet. Some people love salty and are not sensitive to that at all. So it really just depends. Need more research. Saliva. Saliva plays a major role. I put this picture in here because we used to have a Newfoundland and she drooled all the time. So saliva protects your mouth. Saliva protects the tasting receptors in your mouth, but it also works as a liquid carrier, like a vessel to carry the tasting compounds to the taste buds and to the nerves, so that way that it can be broken down and hit those receptors. So that's a large part of how saliva interacts with your mouth. There's actually also a lot of research and new theories pointing towards how we all have different composition of saliva. It's not uniform. It's all basic. It's in the basic range, was a pH above 7. But for the most part, the differences in our genetics or our culture and our mouth affects how we perceive food and our preferences as well. So it can have a really huge impact on what wines you like and which ones you don't. It also has a very large impact on the health of your teeth. After talking to my dentist, because I'm very cavity prone, and he was just like, do you eat a lot of candy? You know, do you have a lot of sugar, sweets? Do you eat a lot of acidic things? I said, well, I make wine, but I don't really drink wine that much, besides when I'm tasting at work, which is maybe once a month. And he said, well, the pH of your mouth just, you know, might not be favorable for the longevity of some of your teeth. So learn something every day. He said, eat more cheese. Like, you have to twist my arm to make me eat more cheese. But yeah, you learn something every day. It's pretty crazy. So saliva also works as a buffer. So saliva is basic. It has a pH anywhere between 6.2 to 7.6. And that is crazy, crazy range for it to be that different between people's. And wine is very acidic, as we already hopefully know. So wine can be anywhere between like 2.99, 2.8, all the way up to 4 sometimes, which is not great, but it can be up there sometimes. So very acidic. You're there with like soda, Coca-Cola, energy drinks, the things that everyone tells you are horrible for you and clean their countertops with in very convincing videos. So yeah, very acidic. So what happens when you take something, excuse me, that is very acidic, and you mix it with something that's very basic, you have positive and negative ions interacting together and conflicting, and they neutralize each other. Opposites attract, opposites neutralize each other. So the positive and negative comes together and forms a neutral. So what's happening is this buffering process in your mouth. So if your mouth, the saliva in your mouth is more basic, you probably have a better tolerance or protection in your mouth when you have acidic foods. Also, tannins are involved with saliva. We'll get to that to the next chapter, so we'll hear more about saliva then. But total acidity is also involved in saliva. This is a measurement that we make on the wine production side to get the total acid. It's also called titratable acidity because it's a titration process. But anyways, what it's doing is it's reenacting how much acid you taste in your mouth. There's lots of different acids in wine, as you're going to see in a couple slides. But we determine through this test how much base do we have to add to that acid to get it up to 8.2 pH. And the more base you have to use, the more acid that it had to cancel out. So you kind of can do this relationship formula to see how much acid was present in the wine. It's different from pH, because pH is more of an indication of health and stability, whereas total acidity is a sensory evaluation measurement. So anyways, that's kind of a little bit of background on that, but it is extremely important, and that is something that we think about on the wine production side. And there's certain values for red wines and white wines and certain varieties and styles that you try to aim for and target for that helps you making the wine. So keep that in mind. So since we've covered that, wow, I apologize because I'm definitely rushing tonight, but that's okay. So let's break it down into the different senses here. We have sweet. So sweetness is often referred to in wine as residual sugar, or RS, and that is, in its purest definition, the remaining sugar left after fermentation. So the residual, what's left behind, right? Sometimes it's not fermented completely on purpose, sometimes on accident. So it just really depends. In other circumstances, sugar can be added to a wine after it's been completed as kind of a back sweetener and a back blender if it's needed. So that's also an option as well. There's different levels of sweetness. For example, something that's bone dry would be a wine that has less than 1 gram per liter of residual sugar in it. And then dry, 1 to 17 grams per liter. Off dry would be 17 to 35. Medium sweet between anywhere between 35 and 120. It's a huge range. And sweet would be over 120 grams per liter. So if you wanted to know the percentage of that, you just take the decimal place and move it over one. So like bone dry would be 0.1%. Dry would be up to 1.7%. Sweet would be 12% residual sugar in the wine. So overall, sweetness is utilized from a winemaking perspective to help smooth out a wine. It helps to coat your mouth, adds richer flavors to the wine, and can help cover excessive acid or tannins sometimes. If too much sugar is added, it has something which I call a saccharin burn, which it can kind of burn the back of your throat if it's not if it's excessive or if it's too much. And some people can perceive that as a high alcohol, which might not be what you're looking for. Sour. So, probably could have guessed it. Sour comes from the natural acids that are found in the grapes, unless it's spoilage like vinegar, and that would be like a volatile acid that you could smell from the wine. But here we're talking about acids that you can taste. So, yes, mostly the most prevalent acid in wine is tartaric acid, and that is something that comes almost exclusively from grapes themselves, tartaric acid. It's also used in a lot of candies for the sour coating. So tartaric and citric acid, if you look on the back of the packages, you'll most likely see a combination of tartaric and citric. Sometimes it's just citric. But the interesting thing about all these different types of acids in grapes is that sometimes winemakers can utilize specific types of acids, even though it's not recommended, because like citric acid for freshness can do some other things into the wine. We can get into that in the winemaking class, but you don't need to know that. But yeah, so like tartaric acid is mostly just tartness. Malic acid is a really sour taste. So if you remember from our secondary fermentation talk, like malic acid is mal, so bad in Spanish. So you think about like an unripe green apple, sour, like tartness. Citric acid from citrus fruits, that's where it gets its name, freshness, kind of that fresh, clean scent, Clorox, lemon scented wipe, it's a wonderful thing. Acetic acid is a vinegar sour aroma, it's an aromatic acid. And then we have these other two, which I really wouldn't worry about. So, like I said before, wine is naturally very acidic, so most wines are tart. So, if you do not have a tolerance for acidic things, wine might not be your thing unless it's like a late harvest. But acid is often utilized in wine because it helps to lift fruity characters. It can help accentuate the fruitiness. But on the flip side, there has a balance that needs to be achieved, just like any component of the wine. If you have too much acid, it can really enhance bitterness and even thin out the body. So the less acid, the more body it has, the more acid you get more fruit. But so there's a balancing act that needs to be played. But overall, the more acid that there is in the wine, it helps keep the longevity and lifespan of the wine. So that's how we do that. Salty, salt is not extremely prominent in wines. But depending on the region that the grapes were grown and the soil, there can be some salinity in the soil, which in excess is definitely not good for the grapevine. But not so much salt in the actual wine. However, salt does help combat bitterness, so that's why pretzels and beer go so well together. Fun fact. Bitter is definitely a problem in winemaking. You can have excessive bitterness. They come from phenolic extractions, mostly from grape seeds, skins, and stems. So if you had excessive crushing of your grapes and you're starting to crush the seeds and and any stems that were in it, that's going to be a problem. You're going to get a lot of those vegetal juices. That's where a lot of the bitterness is honestly, the coating on the outside of the grape seed is bitter because it's meant to be, those compounds are undigestible, so that way when an animal eats the berry, it poops out the seed, and the seed can be planted somewhere and create a new grapevine. That's the morphology. That's the point of that. It can be positive in wine. It can help add some body to it, potentially, and some depth, but it needs to be balanced, just like anything else. It's not favorable when it's overpowering the wine, so that's definitely not something we're looking for. If you want to experience bitterness, the best way you can do it is by crushing up an aspirin and letting it dissolve into some water and tasting that. You can also lick a Nintendo Switch cartridge if you are a video gamer. So these cartridges have been coated in a bitter coating because there was a very large concern that small children would be swallowing these because they're very small. They're very tiny. And arugula is also an offender of something that is bitter naturally on its own. But it's very good for you. It's very good for you. So there you go. Last but not least, we have umami. And umami is basically MSG. Yeah, monosodium glutamate. Yeah, so go to your favorite Chinese restaurant and ask. No, I'm just kidding. You can buy MSG at an Asian food market. You might be able to buy it at Safeway in the little Asian, you know, section. And it is a wonderful flavor enhancer for foods. If you are worried about the adverse health effects that a lot of people are concerned about, you can also find the umami component in a lot of other foods, like shiitake mushrooms is one of the best ones, cured meats and seafood. Umami is a word of Japanese origin, so we don't have an English word for it. But the best way that we describe it in our country, in our language, is savory, something very savory, something meaty, develops a lot of like wonderful mouth, like coating mouthfeel in your mouth when you're tasting it. So, you know, obviously if you're going to do the MSG trial, the best thing to do is dissolve a little bit in a cup of water and then just put it in your mouth, swish it around your mouth. You don't have to swallow it to understand taste and spit it out. You're not going to have any adverse health effects. Obviously, don't drink an entire pitcher of it. Just like anything else, moderation is key. It is a salt, so you will have a high salt reaction to that. So if you do, fun fact, all you have to do is mix a teaspoon of cream of tartar in water and drink the whole thing and then take a nap, and you'll be completely better. And I would know that because I had a reaction to MSG, and that's what saved me. So you learn something, learn a couple things every day. So if we were in person, ideally, what we would do is we would take a wine. Well, first we'd start with standards. You would take, you know, your water, and then you would mix some MSG in it. And then for, you know, for bitter, you would mix some aspirin and some water, and you'd create what we call standards. So these little cups of the different tastes, and you'd start your experiment by tasting just those standards. So you taste those and you try to understand, this is salt, this is acid, this is sweet. You know, sweet, you could obviously just add sugar to water. And then from there, you can taste wine. And you can try to perceive, okay, on a scale of 1 to 10, how sweet is this? How salty? How acidic? How bitter? How much umami is in this wine? And that's how they do it professionally in sensory labs and tests all over. So that would be the best way for you to understand it. If you wanted to manipulate a wine and see what each of those tastes did to the wine, you could do the you could do a very similar thing where you take a wine, keep a control, like a keep a glass set aside that you haven't messed with, so that way you have something to compare it to. Of course, that's the best way to do an experiment. Always have a control. Then you have your different subjects that you tested on. So if you wanted to see what increased tannin and astringency would do, you could soak a tea bag into a glass of the same wine For acid, you can add lemon juice. If you don't have access to like tartaric acid or citric acid, add some lemon juice to the wine. For bitter, of course, add some crushed aspirin. For salty, add salt. For sweet, add sugar. And for umami, add MSG. And the best way for, especially for a newer wine taster who's doing this, it's always good to do more of like the higher end addition first to see kind of an extreme change. Like, whoa, this is way different. Or what you could do is slowly lead up to it. So make very, very small additions on top of each other and taste as you go, so you can see slowly how it's evolving. So there's two different methods of approach there. So like, for example, for acid, say I'm going to add lemon juice to the wine. So I could either A, slowly build up to it. So add maybe just 2 drops to my glass, swirl it, smell it, taste it, take some notes. Add 2 more drops, swirl it, smell it, take some notes, compare it to the control that has nothing in it. It's a regular, and work from there. Or I could just go ahead and add a full squeeze out of the bottle and see on an extreme front what happened to the wine there. So a couple different approaches there. But overall, it's very interesting to see what happens to the wine, especially if you're an aspiring winemaker or a home winemaker. I think that if you're going to consider making acid additions or sugar additions or any type of back blending manipulation before bottling, if you're going to take that route or that approach to winemaking, this is something you should do to understand what exactly it does to the wine. Because with every decision you make, like the sweetness, there's also a consequence as well. You can add too much. So more information for you, basically, whatever you decide to do. So anyways, that is what I got. And I totally blasted through that because we're only at 27 minutes. But I hope that was helpful. If you have questions, please reach out to me. Of course, like always, I can also post other YouTube links as well if you're interested in more information on taste. Not only did I reference our Making Sense of Wine Tasting textbook for this one, but I also used some information from Wine Folly as well. I love this book, even though I have a personal conflict about loving it, because a lot of this information is stolen and the sources aren't cited, and it was used to your own benefit to make money. But that's how the world works, and it's fine. But anyways, you can't change the world, at least not in one night. But anyways, what I'm trying to say is, if you are interested in, you know, how she presents, you can't see any of that, tasting, there you go, you can kind of see it, boom, tasting or different trials, how to decant wine, we can go over that. Structure, smell, wine faults, we'll go over that too. She also has a very nice chart on wine colors. Here we go, here's a good one. Acidity in wine. I have to hand it to her. She does do a very good job, of displaying what she's saying without making it like a really ugly textbook. So if you like pictures, you like colors like me, I definitely recommend it. You can get it on Amazon for like, I think $20. I don't think it's too bad. But yeah, anyways, like I said, reach out if you need help, and keep track of the quizzes, and I will see you guys next time. Awesome.